snakes in the...
I'd like to begin with a quote from the Charles Rivers editors, The Culper Ring, the history and legacy of the Revolutionary War's most famous spy ring. The Charles Rivers editors say, like other spy tales, theirs is a story of courage, fraught with constant suspense at being found out and facing a caught spy's usual fate of imprisonment and execution. I only regret that I have but one life to lose for my country. Those are the famous last words of Nathan Hale. Nathan Hale was just 21 years old when he volunteered for a spy mission in New York City for the Continental Army. He was captured and ultimately executed by hanging on September 22, 1776, when he said those famous last words. The capture and subsequent execution of Nathan Hale is what led George Washington to realize that he needed more sophisticated methods of spying on the British. George Washington and the Continental Army's defeat at the Battle of Long Island had forced them out of New York City. After they departed, the British began using New York City as their main site of operations in the colonies. George Washington had withdrawn to eastern Pennsylvania. Since the British were using New York City as their main site of operations, taking it back was of prime importance for George Washington and the Continental Army. For that reason, in 1778, he asked a young officer in the 2nd Continental Light Dragoons, Benjamin Talmadge, to be his chief of intelligence. Benjamin Talmadge had grown up in the small Long Island town of Setauket, New York. He had graduated from Yale in 1773 and was an officer in the 2nd Continental Light Dragoons. Talmadge had many friends and acquaintances back home in Setauket, which made him a perfect person to establish the spy ring. The town of Setauket was 50 miles from Manhattan, but it was connected by roads used for the transportation of goods in and out of the city. It was in Setauket that Benjamin Talmadge would begin recruiting his friends and acquaintances, people he knew that he could trust, to join him in his intelligence gathering operations. The first person that Talmadge would recruit for his intelligence gathering operation was Abraham Woodhull, a farmer from Setauket. While it's not exactly clear why Abraham Woodhull was keen to spy for the Continentals, rumor has it that Talmadge recruited him when he was caught shipping his farm products to the British in the city and found himself in jail. Talmadge may have secured his release from imprisonment on the condition that he help him with the intelligence gathering and spying operations. Talmadge would describe Abraham Woodhull as extremely cautious, timid, and unwilling to let his identity be known to anyone other than Talmadge himself. From 1778 to 1779, Woodhull made a series of business trips between Setauket and New York City. While he was in New York City, Abraham Woodhull would gather information for George Washington about the things that he heard and he saw while he was there. Washington wanted to know things like the placement of the ships, how many soldiers were there, what the status of the army in New York City was. Abraham Woodhull would mingle with the British in the streets and while he stayed at his sister's boarding house. While there, he could mingle more intimately with the British officers and soldiers who were staying there. And he was in a good position to overhear the things that they might say when they thought no one else was listening. When he would return from Setauket, he would write up a report and he would send it on to General Washington via Caleb Brewster. Caleb Brewster ran whaleboats back and forth across the Long Island Sound, transferring information gathered in Setauket and New York City by Abraham Woodhull to Benjamin Talmadge in Connecticut. Information then went on horseback straight to Washington himself. Anna Strong lived in a cottage with her 8 children across the bay from Abraham Woodhull's farm. Whenever Caleb Brewster was ready to meet, Anna would hang her laundry in a way that would let Abraham know when and where he should meet Caleb Brewster. A black petticoat, which was very unusual for the time, was a sign for Abraham Woodhull that Caleb Brewster had arrived, and the number of white handkerchiefs that she would hang next to that black petticoat would let Abraham know which cove that he should meet Caleb Brewster at. There is no historical record of Anna Strong's part in the Culper spy ring. The stories that we have are stories that have been passed down through generations of her family. Abraham Woodhull became concerned that the British were going to notice that his trips to the city weren't just innocent business trips after all. For that reason, he recruited Robert Townsend to be the main agent in New York City. Robert Townsend operated a grocery and dry goods business, and he was partner in a popular coffee house. He had lots of contact with the British and with the loyalists in the city through the coffee house and the grocery. He was a Quaker, and the Quakers always took a pacifist stance when it came to war. Being a Quaker made Robert Townsend very unlikely to be suspected by the British for having any side in the war. Robert Townsend was also from Oyster Bay, New York, where his family had a home, giving him a perfect excuse to travel between the city and Long Island. Even though he was a Quaker, Robert Townsend was very angry at the British abuse of his family. For this reason, Abraham Woodhull was able to recruit him while he was staying at his sister's boarding house in the city. Townsend would send his information through Austin Rowe back to Setauket. Austin Rowe was a Setauket tavern owner and resident who carried the messages to and from Townsend and other operatives in New York City back to Abraham in Setauket. He and Abraham Woodhull shared a cow field, and he could leave the messages for Abraham in a box that they had hidden in the brush on that cow field. James Rivington was another operative in New York City. He was totally trusted by the British as he printed an extremely pro-British newspaper. Since he was an unquestioned loyalist, he received lots of information from the British. He was also Robert Townsend's partner in the coffee house. He may have turned spy as a way of protecting his family from the Patriots in case the British evacuated the city. Regardless of the reason, Rivington was an enormous source of information for Washington and his spy ring. The spy ring used many techniques to keep their information secret. One of these was invisible ink. They were each given a bottle of ink and a bottle of stain. They would write in the invisible ink, and then as the information was passed on, the next operative would use the stain to decode the words. They would also write in the margins, or sometimes in between the lines of books, just as an extra precaution. After some of Talmadge's information may have been compromised, he came up with a number code to use in place of letters. 763 code numbers were used in place of letters. Each spy was given a book to translate the numerical letters that they received. The Culper Spy Ring is credited with many intelligence successes during the Revolutionary War. One of them was the uncovering of a plan of General Clinton's, where he had planned to send forces to attack the newly landed French army in Rhode Island. The French were warned, and George Washington planted false evidence that the Patriots were coming to New York. Clinton recalled his expedition in order to have as many men there as he could when George Washington attacked New York, which he never did. In Oyster Bay, Robert Townsend's sister Sarah heard the British soldiers talking about West Point. This led to the capture of John Anderson, also known as John Andre, the British Chief of Intelligence, and the uncovering of Benedict Arnold's defection. Arnold's defection was of huge concern for the members of the spy ring because they weren't sure exactly what he knew about them and their operations. Their intelligence also led to the storming of Fort St. George on Long Island. There, Benjamin Talmadge and his men burnt a large stockpile of hay that the British Army needed, and they took about 50 prisoners. The Culper Spy Ring was essential to the success of the Revolutionary War. The name Culper was actually thought of by George Washington, and it was a play on words using the name of his hometown of Culpeper, Virginia. He also came up with the idea of using the name Samuel Culper to represent Abraham Woodhull in the letters. None of the members of the Culper Spy Ring were actually caught by the British, and all of them lived relatively long lives. Benjamin Talmadge died at age 81 in 1835 after he married the daughter of Declaration of Independence signer William Floyd. Caleb Brewster also married and settled at a farm in Fairfield, Connecticut. In 1793, he took a job with the U.S. Revenue Marine. The Revenue Marine were used for the enforcement of customs laws. Caleb Brewster commanded a revenue cutter during the War of 1812. He died at age 80 in 1827. Abraham Woodhull remained in Setauket. He married and had three children and served as the Suffolk County Magistrate from 1799 to 1810. He freed his slaves and he died at age 75 in 1826. Anna Strong also remained in Setauket with her husband, Selah, and her nine children. Robert Townsend returned to Oyster Bay. He never married and he died at age 84 in 1838. His home, Ranham Hall, is now a museum. James Rivington tried to publish a Patriot newspaper after the war, but he was shut down. He lived in poverty and died in 1802 at the age of 78. Austin Rowe continued to operate his tavern. He died in 1830 at age 81. His tavern still stands today. One of the members of the spy ring, spy number 355, was a New York society woman. To this day, her identity is still not known. There are many candidates who could possibly be 355, including Anna Strong. Another candidate is Sally Townsend. Sally Townsend was the younger sister of Robert Townsend. Colonel Simcoe of the Queen's Rangers was quartered in her house, Ranham Hall. It's possible that she had overheard things that she could pass on to her brother. There is even the rumor that she is the one who uncovered Benedict Arnold's plot by hearing the officers quartered in her house, speaking of West Point. Mary Underhill is another candidate for 355, she being Abraham Woodhull's younger sister and the keeper of the boarding house in New York City. Peggy Shippen Arnold could also have been 355. She was the wife of Benedict Arnold. Her family was more moderate than loyalist, however, and she carried on a strong relationship with Major Andre before his capture and execution. It's possible that she blamed Arnold for Andre's execution. And for that reason, she may have been willing to work against him. Another possibility is Elizabeth Bergen. She worked hard to secure blankets and clothing and medicine to the Patriots within New York. Also, unbeknownst to the British, she helped to smuggle prisoners off of the prison ships to their freedom. There is no concrete evidence to support any of these women actually being 355. Everything is circumstantial. The fact that even today we can't find evidence of this is just a testament to how secretive and effective that the Culper Spy Ring was during the Revolutionary War. These brave men and women, through their courage and heroism, helped to secure the rights and freedoms that we have today. They were willing to lay down their lives for their country and for the cause of liberty, and we should all be thankful for their sacrifice.
There's snakes in the garden, blood on the vines. Every time I slip away, it feels like a crime.
Underneath the shadows, the aching ground, the gray of the moon is all we have now.
In the hallway, scars in the silver. I know there will come a day when red runs the river.